afternoon sports drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Friday edition. It is the best edition because we're getting you into your weekend here on Triple Play Sports. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Levi Peckinpah with you. I'm live at Vance Chevrolet Buick GMC here in Perry, Oklahoma, just off I-35 at Perry Exit 186. With new vehicle inventories very limited, like a new pre-owned vehicle just might be your best option. Vance and Perry has a low mileage 2020 and 21 models, plus 2018s and 2019s with low miles, over 70 pre-owned vehicles now on the lot out here at Perry. And there's over 400 pre-owned vehicles to choose from in the 7 dealership John Vance Group. Visit www.vancechevrolet.net. Boys, what's going on? Happy Friday to you.
What's up? Happy Friday.
Yes, sir.
How was that trip back last night?
I tell you what, it was actually going well, okay, heading back from Arlington. It was going well until I got right outside of Oklahoma City, and it's standstill traffic, okay?
Yep.
And I'm like, I'm sure you ran into it too. I'm like, what's going on? You know, that must be an accident or something. And no, you know, you just go through, and all it was a little road work on the side, but people cannot stop, craning their necks, slamming on the brakes, taking their time. So, of course, ran into that. But other than that, it was smooth. I was surprised. Even the traffic outside of Arlington wasn't that bad.
Yeah, we didn't leave too much after you did. We left the facility at, like, I don't know, 5:40, I think, 5:45. And traffic was a little, because we went the north side over by the airport, so it was a little busy over there. But like you said, it was like, I think it was a mile north of the mile of cars there in Norman, all those dealerships. What was it, 3 or 4 lanes of traffic down to 1 lane?
Oh.
But the problem was,
yeah,
they had the left lane that closed ahead sign, but it was only like a quarter of a mile from the sign to the closure. And so you had 3 lanes of traffic condensing, and then once you got under the overpass, there was an off ramp that exited onto the highway, and then they closed the middle lane. So everyone, so you had 3 lanes down to 2 lanes down to 1 lane in less than like a half a mile. Dude, it was a nightmare, an absolute nightmare. And now
and
I will say,
you had everybody on the left. You had everybody on the left side that was trying, you know, just force their way in. They're like, let me in. I realized I got over too late. Let me in. So that was also a disaster
We had 3 or 4 big trucks, like the big jacked up, you know, 4x4, you know, Dodge Dualies, just hauling ass. And then, like, I'm talking, they hauled ass all the way to the cones that shut down the left lane and forcibly got their way over. It was like, what are you doing?
Goodness, that
I will say, thankfully, it was only like 10
minutes. I wish those people
a
very sad day. I wish them a very sad rest of their day. Let me just tell you that. Because there were a lot of them that did that.
So awful.
Man, had a lot of bad traffic back here. No, I'm kidding. I didn't have to deal with that type of stuff. But I'll tell you one thing. By the time the end of the day hit, I also did some stuff over for TV 31. Once 9 o'clock hit, I went home and I passed out for 11 straight hours.
It's been a long couple days, man.
It has tallied up a lot.
It has been a long couple days.
We're here, though. We're trying to get through this show, and we're going to hopefully have a good one.
And the good thing about that, we have a ton of stuff to talk about.
Yes.
We have so much material because while, you know, Patrick and I talked about it yesterday, while we didn't, like, learn about the teams, there's plenty of talking points from just about every single team.
No, there definitely is, and that's where we're going to start the show with kind of a little bit of a Big 12 Media Days recap. We'll take a look at a few things we noticed and maybe, you know, stood out to us while we were there. Coming up later, we'll get into some news about Cam Newton. The NCAA keeps on falling apart, and Richard Sherman made news over the last couple of days, too, that we'll dive into much, much more. Coming up here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, but first, like Zach mentioned, Big 12 Media Days. It was a fun couple of days. You got a lot of good stuff from the coaches, from players. We got some great sound bites personally from Oklahoma State guys, including Mike Gundy and company, Malcolm Rodriguez, Spencer Sanders. And you know, I think it was also a few things. When Mike Gundy got up there, you know, there were a couple of guys, especially in the Big 12 overall for these coaches, that were, you know, trying to kind of keep up this new persona that they've got. I'm talking like Dave Aranda, for instance, as well as, Steve Sarkisian, guys that were trying to kind of, you know, make a smooth transition here into the Big 12. And then you get Mike Gundy, right, who's been here for a billion years. He comes on in, and some of the questions are, you know, obviously about what's going to happen this upcoming season. Where are we looking ahead towards Oklahoma State football? How is Spencer Sanders? And honestly, if you go back to that right there when he's talking about Spencer Sanders, I don't know about you, Zach, but I thought personally he had a lot of great things to say in terms of not just coach speak, but really feeling confident, like, hey, you know, he's had one of the best off seasons here that I've seen. He's worked his tail off. He's made a lot of improvements. And I don't see Mike Gundy just throwing that out there to kind of, you know, keep everybody satisfied. I really, truly believe. And then, of course, when we talked to Spencer Sanders later on, he had that persona like, hey, man, I have been putting in the work. I feel good about where I'm at. And overall, you combine those two together, I feel like it's at least, if anything, a good insight. And we can stay hopeful that Spencer Sanders is going to come out of the gates hopefully on fire for this upcoming season.
Yeah, and I think that Spencer's comments when he talked to us, I think those are more important than what we heard from Gundy, you know, because I'm not going to say that 100% of what Gundy said was coach speak, because Gundy's pretty straight. You know, he's pretty straightforward when it comes to what he wants to say. Like his comments about the new leadership, Dr. Casey Shrum, the new president, and obviously Chad Weiberg, the athletic director, that very, very good and candid comments. But when Spencer sat down with us and we asked him about his first full offseason in spring with quarterbacks coach Tim Rattay, the level of confidence, and we've heard a lot of coach speak from Spencer over the past couple of years. He's very level-headed. He's not going to give you, he's going to accept all responsibility. You know, he doesn't, and he said that to us, you know, you can put the blame on me from last year. I don't care what you do. And he does that during the season. But when he started talking about himself, and, you know, you brought up the question, he was like, yeah, it all starts with footwork. Footwork helps, you know, vision and everything on the way up. I think we listened to it on the way home. We listened to Big 12 Now on Sirius XM. Robert and I did, and that's all they could talk about was Spencer Sanders and what they feel he improved upon and what Gundy had to say about Spencer. And so far, I mean, we've yet to see him out in a game since the spring. But it would appear that everything we heard throughout the spring about his progression and his footwork and his timing and his vision and going through progressions, it appears that on the surface, at least, it appears to be true. And so I am very much looking forward to getting out there and watching him during fall camp. And again, you're not going to learn anything from fall camp, but you can see the progressions made throughout the spring and the offseason and fall camp. And I'm really, really looking forward to the start of the season. You know, we talked about how the defense has really improved, and I cannot wait to see the defense. But after listening to Spencer, I got to say I'm very excited to see what these progressions are. Because he took what he did in the Miami game, and he's apparently carried it over, and he's really confident, and Gundy is really confident. Let's see if that translates, but I'm looking forward to it, Levi.
Yeah, Spencer yesterday to me was the highlight of all the Big 12 days, because, to be honest, everything else felt kind of like your generic coach
speak. Very forced, yeah.
It felt like it's like, we are forced to be here by the Big 12. We will give you your usual quotes that you expect. And then Spencer was the only one that truly, honestly, not only showed up with confidence, but also showed up with, like, his personality. Everybody else just felt like they were forced and canned to be there. But Spencer felt like he was actually genuinely excited to be there and show up and show his personality, because he's that confident in himself going through everything that he's been through, not only in the spring, but in the summer. That's something that's actually really incredible to see, that somebody showed up and they were actually prepared to get through all of
this.
Well,
and I will say this, Patrick. One of the comments he gave during the breakout session, it's in Marshall Levinson's article on Pokes Report. This is a quote he said. He was asked about what Tim Rattay has been able to help him, you know, develop over the past year or so. And he goes on to say, I would say operate in the offense and decision-making – And then another follow-up question on Rete about the tweaks or possible changes to what the offense was last year to this year. And he goes, it's really just dialing in on what we did like before I was here. It was air raid. The ball was here. The ball was there. It was great. Mason Rudolph was slinging it everywhere, and Cornelius was too. I think it's just about getting back to those habits, and I think it's going to be a lot like what it used to be. The fact that you have a dual-threat quarterback who has a really good arm saying, you know what, Tim Rete, we've worked on my footwork, we worked on my decision making, my timing. Guess what? We're gonna try to air it out this year. I think would have to make any football fan, especially an Oklahoma State fan, excited.
That's the best news you could possibly hear,
right?
Because that means we are finally, after what, 2 years of saying we need to open up the playbook back again.
Especially if the offensive line is healthy and it does have depth and can protect him back there.
Yeah, that shot of optimism is something that everybody should just hold on to and be like, yes, if this is the direction we are finally going after, a couple years of saying we need to get back to that, and now that Spencer has the confidence developed in the system, it's definitely the right direction
and
to go for Oklahoma
State. The
good thing
is he's elite on his feet.
Yes.
And he can, if the pocket does have some collapse, he can get out of it. He can pick you up yardage and get you a first down.
Compared to like Mason Rudolph whenever
he
could not scramble. And he was one of those guys Mason would try to go outside the pocket, it was you held your breath because he had super tunnel vision of like 1 inch in front of himself.
The only time it was good was the Texas Tech game when he ran it in for that touchdown.
Yes.
That was it.
Besides that, it was like 20 other thousand fumbles.
Yikes.
It was bad.
Yeah, I'm like you guys. When I heard that, it did get me excited as well. Like, okay, that's we want to hear that. Now let's see it happen.
Yeah,
you know, let's actually see this translate into the season. Let's see it opened up a little bit because, yes, there were many time last year. And I understand the offensive line was obviously an issue. We were like, man, what? Come on now. Why are we calling this in this situation? But that happens every single season with different times. We understand it. But it's true that you open it up a little bit more. You know, you have that ability with these running backs to do play action. And when you had Mike Gundy as well being really candidly honest about the offensive line last year, I thought that was also something that was big time. You know, he's like, hey, he even said, I'm going to be honest with you guys. I try to always be. Offensive line, it wasn't good. You know, we were switching guys around, and he didn't try to say it was their fault by any means. Just trying to switch guys around. We had young guys. We had to make do with what we had. So many injuries. But we feel like this year we're set. We're back, good to go on that that front. And we feel like that can open everything up. Like you mentioned, Spencer gave a lot of credit to the offensive line as well coming into this year, knowing that, hey, if they're set, that means we can do whatever we want offensively and install our game plan. That gives him more confidence. I thought he was, Spencer personally, was also very giving and understanding towards all of his other players, which doesn't surprise me at all, giving him a lot of credit. But when I heard that about the offensive line, I mean, it's obviously something that you love to hear a coach not mix words whenever he's being candid like that. So that was good on Gundy, I thought. The offensive line knows that. They come back better and stronger than last year, coming in healthy. And if they can stay that way, as you guys have said and as we know, it can open up so much for Oklahoma State, especially on that, you know, offensively in terms of what they want to do when they're trying to kind of figure out their identity a little bit more this year without some of their big-time playmakers returning.
No, absolutely. You know, and it's something that I think every fan base goes through this. You know, you want your coach to, you know, maybe cut with a coach speech, a little bit, you know, tell, you know, we know you're frustrated just like us, say it, you know, and that's something that I think that comfortability from Gundy comes from new leadership. You know, he's obviously, you can tell that he's happy that there's new leadership, not necessarily that the educational side, but you know, you got a new athletic director, you have a new president, you have the football coach, all working in concert together now, so you can tell that he is more confident, more comfortable. And so when he came out with, like you said, you know, and talked about how there were guys that played last year that really had no business playing last year, and they were hurt, and this is, you know, this was something that it was probably way worse than what you thought it was and what we thought it was. And if what's optimistic about that situation is when you look at how abysmal the offensive line was last year, they still did pretty well. They still won 8 games, you know. And if you tack on 2 more non-conference games in a non-COVID year, you're setting at 10-3. You know, I mean, that's a hell of a season. You know, another 10-win season. And so if you look at the guys that return, you know, Tevin Jenkins is a big loss. But if you look at the guys that returned last year to this season, you know, you bring in Danny Godlewski, you've got Josh Sills, you know, you've got a guy like Hunter Woodard. You're bringing in a left tackle in Caleb Etienne, who's 6'9", came in at 360, 370, and they've dropped him down a little bit. I think now he's roughly 6'8", 6'9", 350, 355, 360, something like that. That's a huge body. But you look at the depth and the experience last year, if they can stay healthy, I mean, they can protect Spencer, and everything starts with the offensive line. And Gundy mentioned the fact that they've got at least four running backs that they're all very confident that can go out and get really good reps and play really well. So you combine a good offensive line with a more confident, a more centered Spencer Sanders, a good stable of running backs. Apparently the receiver core, you know, we're listening to him. You know, Tay Martin is in the best shape of his life. Brennan Presley comes back. You've got Braden Johnson. You got the Green Twins that might be able to make an impact this year. I mean, there's everything looks to be in place to have a solid season. Now, obviously, everything has to come together. I'm not counting my chickens before they hatch. But everything looks to be in place, and we'll have to see. But I'm certainly looking more forward to it than I was last week.
Oh, yeah. I think also everybody just in genuine is looking more forward to it, because now that we got the Big 12 Media Days done and over.
Well, it's like 2 weeks.
Yeah, that means the season's right around the corner.
Fall camp, baby.
Oh, yeah. We are almost there. And for the season, because I'm glad we got the more confident Spencer Sanders with the talk about the offensive line, because I really think even though a lot of the talk is going to be about Spencer, the offensive line to me is what you need to circle about this Oklahoma State squad. That is going to be where the do or die action happens. If we go back to musical chairs like last year, it's going to be another tough season. But if the depth is there, if the confidence is there with the offensive line, if hopefully you don't see any injuries down the stretch, that's what you really don't need if you're this Oklahoma State offensive line, then this season, it's going to be a wild one, but in the good sense of the way.
The other big story that came out of Big 12 Media Days, and I don't know about you guys, but I saw this all over a bunch of different national shows and publications and things like that today, was Mr. Burks coming out and talking about, for Big 12 officiating, specifically the horns down issue in Big 12 and in Big 12 play. And, of course, tried to explain that if a player does the horns down logo to the crowd, then they probably won't get a penalty. However, if it's directed at somebody else, like a player or a coach or something like that, they probably will get a penalty, because all that totally makes sense. Because, you know, we definitely want to protect everybody's feelings, especially when we're playing football out of all sports. That's the main thing we focus on when we go out there every Saturday and Sunday. We want to protect everybody's feelings. But whenever that was talked about, I was just like, again, really? We got to go back and address this and talk about how dumb this is, how soft it makes Texas look, how soft it makes the players look. And if anything, this just gives other players more ammunition. How are referees going to determine whether, you know, when someone on another team, whether it's an Oklahoma State player or whatever, does it? Oh, was that aimed at the crowd? Oh, if so, we can't throw it. It was aimed at that player, though. Oh, then we got to throw that flag. It's a penalty. It's so ridiculous. When I heard that, I think everybody there was just kind of like, seriously, as if, you know, and Texas was like, as if we didn't need everyone else ganging up on us for another reason. You know, we're already doing the whole Texas is back thing. Steve Sarkisian's in the house trying to calm all that down. Now we got to do this with the Longhorns down logo, and I thought that was just or the symbol, and I thought that was just funny again to see us have to go through that one more time. And you know you're going to see it a ton overall in the season.
I'm glad that this rule's not going anywhere, so I'm glad that they came out and amended it and said, you know, if a player flashes it and it's at the crowd, chances are they're probably not going to get a penalty. But at what point are you going to start to see the officials say, well, there was a player in the vicinity.
Yeah.
You know, it looked like you were looking at the crowd, but it could have been misconstrued. Texas might be the softest organization in college football, which is a bad look to have right now when you have a new head coach who, let's be honest, has had a lot of success. He's won a couple of national championships. He's taken four teams to the national championship. He obviously knows about winning, but when he comes out and he's like, you know, we got to rebuild the culture. You know, we can't just show up with the most money, the best facilities, you know, the best education, this and that, this and that, and the 4 and 5 stars and just expect to win.
Yeah.
You know, we got to rebuild from the ground. Well, that's great, but all of a sudden, you know, we're rebuilding, but we're not allowed to, you know, you guys can't horns down us. That's mean.
We got to be sheltered. Here's the thing. The good thing is once the final whistle blows, then you'll do the horns down to the players.
What are you going to do?
What are you going to do after that point?
Throw a post-game flag?
Yeah.
It's going to tack 15 on to the next game?
Exactly.
Get out of here.
Exactly. You can get those horns down after the final whistle, and then you can go home and cry.
I will say this. The one problem that I really had with what Sarkisian had to say, and I don't know, Levi, how much you listened to the coaches' pressers during the day. But when Sarkisian came out and he was like, you know, we can't – just because we have 4 and 5 star guys, you know, we're not going to win with just 4 and 5 star guys. You're not going to win a championship with that. And I'm sitting there thinking, like, what did you win those national championships with prior? Were they 4 and 5 star guys, or were – you know, because I guarantee you – that Nick Saban's not going to taking his staff and going to Kansas and winning a title in the next 4 years. It ain't happening. You win titles with 4 and 5 star guys.
It's 4 and 5 star guys, but being able to have that 4 and 5 star coaching. It's that perfect combination. Hopefully Sarkisian can have that type of coaching ability over there at Texas, which that's what I'm saying, hoping for their sake. But it's being able to have that combo of great coaching and great players. That's whenever you take that next step up. For Oklahoma State, they usually get a couple really good star athletes, but the good thing is for Mike Gundy and their crew, they are pretty much a development type of crew where they take a lot of 2-3 star guys and you make them play like 4-5 star
Well,
athletes.
That's the good thing with Gundy is they bring in guys that were just they weren't recruited. Mm-hmm. You know, they weren't noticed by the recruiting play. Because you're telling me that James Washington is not a – you're telling me he's a 2-star athlete? You're telling me that James Washington, Biletnikoff Award winner, is 2 stars?
Mm-hmm.
Get out of here, man. If James Washington were at a big 6A school in Texas, he'd be a 5-star.
Mm-hmm. Are you 5?
Yeah, it's, there was a lot of great stuff that we took away from Big 12 Media Days, and we'll obviously a lot of it throughout the upcoming weeks and all of that because there were a ton of good sound bites. And we'll even play Spencer Sanders later today for those that didn't get to hear it yesterday. He gave Zach and I a great interview yesterday in Arlington. We come back on the afternoon sports drive. I will tell you guys why Cam Newton just gave me another reason to love him. That's coming up next here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Welcome back into the afternoon sports drive here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. On this Friday, the weekend is here, and we're getting you set and ready for it here on the afternoon sports drive. I'm live from Vance Chevrolet Buick GMC in Perry, just off I-35 here at Perry Exit 186. It is the best time ever to get top dollar for your trade-in. Right now, you've probably heard stories about how much people are getting for their trade-ins. That's exactly what you'll get when you trade with Van Chevy Buick GMC in Perry. Your great trade-in helps you get your order in on a new vehicle. It's called pre-selling, and it's a great way to get the absolute most ever for your trade-in while you're locked in on exactly what you want. All right, Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, and Levi Peckinpah here with you on this Friday. And I told you guys I was going to give you another reason for me to just, love Cam Newton. Like Cam Newton's my guy, always has been, even ever since college. Him coming into the league, I was always rooting for him, wanting him to have success. Obviously, last year was a strange year. I was encouraging and hoping for a lot of success, the fit with the Patriots. I thought it was a great move. I called the move. I didn't actually know if it would ever happen, but it did, and so I was thrilled to see that come to light. But then obviously last year, as we saw, not quite working out. Didn't go well. I think it was, what, 10 interceptions to his 8 touchdowns. But he sat down with the ESPN earlier, and here's what he had to say. He said, "For me, the Patriots organization has been impeccable. So my time there has been everything I could ask for. I guess it's now time for me to uphold my end of the bargain through and through." He goes on to say, "I know who I am. At times I do remind myself people forget who you are and what you've done. So now I'm in a position where I need to be myself. It's really put up or shut up time." And I think the biggest thing I take from all this is, because the Patriots drafting Mac Jones, clearly we know there's going to be a real open competition going on here in just a couple of weeks. And there may be a different face even when the season starts. I know that Bill Belichick has said it, and it's going to be Cam Newton, but we'll see. You know, I still hold out expectations a little bit that we might see Mac Jones sooner rather than later. But let me say this. Cam Newton saying what he said there just makes me understand more about where he's coming from, because you hear about so many different quarterbacks that have been in situations like this before, whether they're with a new team or they had success in the past and a year comes where they don't have success, and they immediately blame that failure on anything else but themselves. We always hear a bunch of different excuses. You know, it can be coaches, it can be injuries, it can be players, all this stuff, whatever, and it goes on from there. Cam has a ton of self-awareness, and he's always been wildly entertaining, very, very intelligent, and I really want him to succeed. And him coming out saying this, you know, makes me understand that he's also up for that challenge that Mac Jones presents. He's not going to roll over. He's been there. He's done that. But he wants to make sure he fights for this job and wants this job again. It feels like he owes the Patriots for not really doing what he expected or what they expected out of him last season. Now, there was obviously also a lack of playmakers. We know that, too. But, again, it's not an excuse that he used. It would have been really, really easy for him to say, "Hey, I didn't have anybody out there to throw the football to," because he did. Or it would have been really easy for him to say, "Ah, you know, the injury just wasn't quite where I thought I was in terms of my rehab, and it just flared up," you know. But, no, it was on me. I messed up. I'm coming back this year, and I'm looking forward to what I can do in terms of being my old self. And I thought that's highly respectable of a guy like Cam Newton, because it is so easy to use those excuses, especially when a young guy's coming up. You could give up and give the job over to him, but that's not his plan at all, and I respect him for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to give him a lot of respect, because not only just on the NFL, but almost any type of place and thing, you can use an excuse to get out of it easy and deflect it onto something else. But you got to give the respect to the man for saying, "Nah, no excuses aside, I did not play that great last season, and I'm going to try to make up for it." He's not going to give the job automatically to Mac Jones, which I don't think anybody in the Patriots organization expected him to, and I think that's why they kept it around, because he knew personally that he did not live up to the ability that not only the Patriots organization wanted out of him, but he wanted out of himself. He knew no matter what, you could have said the talent or anything like that that was surrounding him, he just knew in his own heart that he didn't play up to the way that he wanted to play. And you got to respect that, because there's a lot of other guys in almost any other way of life that would throw out some type of excuse to cover their hind end. And I think that he's going to have a pretty good year. I think he's going to figure out what in the heck's up with his arm, even though we've been wanting him to do that for the past couple of years. But I think since he knows that this is definitely one of his last shots at most likely being a starting QB in the NFL, that he is going to give it 110% until his arm falls off, which, honestly, for Cam Newton, there's a good shot that that happens. So I think he'll most likely hang on to that starting QB job, I hope for the whole season, because I think he has that ability to do so. But you just got to hope for him that his play just doesn't drop off like it's done for a couple times with the Panthers, or how it did last year for the Patriots.
No, I completely agree. I think it also a big part of it, too, is he understands, look, Mac Jones provides real pressure. He really, really does. And I think Cam is up to the challenge, but he also knows the clock is ticking.
Yeah.
And that the Patriots know that, too. They can't afford to miss again. That's the biggest part of it all. The Patriots cannot afford to miss when it comes to quarterback right now, not just because of who they are and then, you know, their legacy and where they've been in the league, but think about it as far as the division. Mm-hmm. I mean, this has become a situation where it's not just another teams that are decent. The Bills are one of the best teams in the entire National Football League.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, they've got a better opportunity to make it than the Patriots do right now. So I think they're looking at it as a situation where it's not just, hey, we want to avoid another down season. Just no. We want to avoid the ultimate slide down where we never come back, or at least it's going to be a long time. Because we don't have Tom Brady. We tried to make some moves at some wide receiver positions, and we did. We added some people. Whether that's going to pan out or not remains to be seen. We had some changes in the organization. The good news is, as far as quarterbacks, we still have Josh McDaniels. We know how good he is. But we have a situation at quarterback where we're not quite sure what we're going to get. You hope with Cam Newton. At least you might know it's either going to be good or it's going to be like last year, and then you can go to Mac Jones. Or you say Mac Jones outperformed him in the offseason. We don't want to waste any time. We want to give Mac Jones a shot. If he's not good, we slip him right back in and hope that we can get some wins. This is a team that's still with Bill Belichick at the helm. Anything is possible. That's why I think they're not out of it by any means. But they do know that they're towing a very, very thin line right now. And it all starts at quarterback. And whether it's Mac Jones or whether it's Cam Newton, you know, all dynasties have to fall at some point. But they have no interest in doing that, especially in an AFC right now that is so competitive. They know that, hey, one more wrong step, it's kind of like the minefield situation. You know, one wrong step and this whole thing's going to blow up on us. And we might never have a chance, or at least it'll be a long time before we come back. Because all of a sudden, we've got Patrick Mahomes to deal with every year. We've got Josh Allen to deal with every year. We've got Justin Herbert to deal with every year. You've got Baker Mayfield starting to wake up. You never know. Lamar Jackson might actually get, whenever the throwing becomes even better for him, he could become elite before it's all said and done. There's so much in the AFC alone that they have to deal with. I really think that right now it's hit or miss, and they can't afford to miss again. And Cam understands that and knows that he's going to be a big reason whether they do or don't.
Oh, yeah. They definitely can't miss, because even with the Bills on top, you still have the Dolphins, who had one of the best defenses last year, had one of the best corners last year in Xavier Howard. And depending on the potential of Tua Tagovailoa, whether or not the Dolphins want to throw him to the Sharks and just let him fall out to the wind, or if they're actually going to allow him the chance to develop, he could turn out to be pretty good. The Jets, I mean, even though the Jets offensively are abysmal, that defense is still one of the best factors of the New York Jets. I think that's a top 10, top 5 defense right there with the New York Jets. So could throw Cam Newton and or Mac Jones some trouble. Really, besides the Jets, that conference or that division is wide open. I mean, you can even go conference-wise. There's so much competition there that if the Patriots even slip up just a tiny bit, you are out of luck, because there's so many people that will be vying for those wild card spots, with there, again, being 3 wild card spots. It's going to be tough. So that means Bill Belichick and Cam Newton and Mac Jones, depending on how things go for Cam Newton down the road, have to be clicked in on every level throughout the season. Because one tiny mess up, if Cam Newton goes out and they bring in Mac Jones a little bit too late, or if Mac Jones isn't feeling the rhythm and then you have to bring back in Cam Newton, you do that 1 second too late, you do that a couple plays too late, and the Patriots end up losing a game, they will be out of the running for a playoff spot. And the Patriots, like you said, could hit that spiral like we've seen so many other teams do, whether it was the Rams, who haven't been able to make it back to the Super Bowl even though having a great defense, the Falcons, who 28-3 themselves, Jaguars, who were on that big rise. You can go through so many teams that have been trying to make steps, but they realize that once you hit that point, if you can't take that next step, then you got to hit the spiral.
Yeah, I really do wonder how long ago 2018 seems like to the Patriots organization, because it really wasn't that long ago. But look how quickly things change in the league. It's pretty unbelievable. But bottom line, really respect Cam Newton for everything he's done and said most of his career. He's always been a guy to own up to it, and he's done that a lot more, too, in his older age in the league, and I respect him for it. When we come back on the afternoon sports drive, the NCAA maybe has finally accepted its fate. Now that NIL and everything else is in place, Mark Emmert had some words that might have just sealed the deal. We'll talk about that coming up next here on the afternoon sports drive. Showed you true colors, I don't like what I see. Story keeps changing, I know what that means. Know what that means, I know what that means. How'd you go from being that somebody I believed into being someone that was me behind the scenes? Can't forgive it, sorry that I ain't never received. I mean, least you could've done was gave me an apology. But you're so prideful. Yeah. Prideful. Taking what you need, blame it on me, man, that's so. Welcome back into the afternoon sports drive here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, and Levi Peckinpah with you today on this Friday. I'm live from Van Chevrolet Buick GMC in Perry. The John Vance way is to make it easy and comfortable for you to buy a new or pre-owned vehicle. Check out the reviews the customers have made on Facebook, Google, and with General Motors. Vance Perry reviews are consistently in the 4.7 to 4.8 range out of 5 because Rod Norris and everyone involved with Van Chevy Buick GMC are consistent in how they take care of customers. It's also why so many are Vance repeat customers. So I saw this this statement from Mark Emmert recently and president of the NCAA, and it makes me wonder if this finally means that, in a way, they've given up. Because he said, quote, "This is the right time to consider decentralizing college sports when it comes to the NCAA." So they need to rethink what college sports is all about. Said, quote, "When you have an environment like that, it just forces us to think more about what constraints should be put in place ever on college athletics, and it should be the bare minimum. We need to be ready to say, you know, for field hockey is different than football. Wrestling is different than lacrosse. And not get so hung up on having everything be the same. Need to embrace that with NIL out there. We're providing our other opportunities around the whole notion of using college sports as a career launching pad." And it makes me once again say, because once NIL officially came in, once the Supreme Court ruled the way that they did in that 9-0 favor of the student athletes, I think that it really put it into perspective and put the question out there, okay, what good is the NCAA anymore? As a national governing body, what can it possibly do anymore? I asked that question to both of you, I think, at one time. Was, you know, does this effectively end the NCAA as we know it? Because I still think, you know, what is the point anymore when we're right here at this point in time knowing how little they can do anymore? In a matter of a couple of weeks, they have become virtually irrelevant. And I think Mark Emmert at least somewhat understands that. So for all of those people as well, I thought about this too, you know, that are hating on name, image, and likeness and everything else, because there's plenty of them out there. Trust me, we've heard them. Maybe you should change your tune, because at the same time, the NCAA is virtually dissolving before your very eyes. And I know there's not a lot of people that are just giant NCAA fans. So I think that this is maybe the acceptance of Mark Emmert knowing, hey, there's not as much as we can do anymore. It's certainly not going to be a situation where we're going to be overbearing on different investigations and things like that and checking every little thing. And I think he sees the kind of flashing before his very eyes that, hey, what once was the NCAA is absolutely no longer. And personally, guys, I got to tell you, I couldn't be more happy to see that.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those things, and that was one of the main driving question points when it came to student athletes yesterday. You know, and Bowlesby was asked about it, and coaches were asked about it, and I understand there's some people that are upset about NIL. All right, I get that. You know, college football and college athletics as a whole has been a certain way for decades. But the fact that you now have I find it crazy that you can sit back and look at this multi-billion dollar industry across the board. I'm not saying one school, but across the board, it's multi-billion dollar industry, and you have these kids that, let's be honest, for a lot of people, it's not the program. Now, there's obviously you get alumni and you get big supporters that have been fans of these programs for a while. But it's not necessarily the program. It's the fact that you can go out there, let's say Spencer Rattler, you know, for OU, or Colby Harvell-Peel, or Tua Tagovailoa a few years back, or Cam Newton, right? These guys are generating money. You know, when you look at Oklahoma State and how much money they bring in on a given game day, sure, it's Oklahoma State, and sure, it's the program. But it's the fact that you have a guy like James Washington and Mason Rudolph out there,
yeah,
that are scoring 45, 50, 60 points a game and winning national honors. And so the fact that you can sit there and say, yeah, this program, like those numbers I gave you a few weeks back, Alabama bringing in, you know, close to $200 million in a fall, mm-hmm, because of football, you're telling me that this guy – this 18, 19-year-old kid who's going out there and scoring all these touchdowns, who's helping bring in this money, can't sign some autographs and make some money off of himself? And you're upset that now he can sign autographs and take pictures and say, hey, I'm sorry, but that's going to be $100. like, well, that just taints the amateurism. Well, I mean, this dude is bringing in millions of dollars, but it's okay because he gets a $2,000 a month stipend. Get out of here with that. You can miss me with that.
Yeah, allow them to make some of that cash. They deserve it. If they're helping to bring in, like you said, for Alabama, that $200 million, and they can't even see $20 back on an autograph, or because that's what some kids right. might draw in, or for like some of the biggers, like $100, right. $250,
even more, yeah.
or be able to advertise with somebody and bring in that cash. If they can't bring in that revenue, and let's be honest, with some of these students, yes, you might get a little bit back through the college, but the majority of it, some of these kids are going to be going broke throughout college. They need a little cash
yeah,
around
and I'm not,
the side.
I'm not broken up about the NCAA, you know, and because you look at it, and we've talked about it for months. The NCAA has known this is coming
yeah.
for a long while, and it was almost like, well, if we put it on the back burner, if we don't talk about it, if we act like it's not that big of a deal, it's going to get swept away. It's going to get swept under the rug. You know, these kids that are all on their phones and TikToks and social media, they'll get disinterested, they'll get bored with it, they'll move on to something else.
How many times has
that's
the,
not the case?
How many times has the NCAA done that with so many stuff?
Well, I'll tell you, that's the thing. And honestly, I think that if the NCAA would have got ahead of this a few years ago, or even at the start of this year, or the you know the middle of last year, mm-hmm. and gotten ahead of this and partnered up with colleges and got together, you know, with state legislatures and stuff like this, it's not inconceivable that the NCAA could have been a part of this and moving forward and been integral part of it. Now, we all know the NCAA is crooked and does everything about money for themselves, and they were going to hold March Madness no matter what because they lost $750 million last year not playing it.
Yeah.
But if Mark Emmert and the rest of the board of directors and the NCAA and everything, if they'd have got ahead of this and been proactive, they very easily could have been a part of this and not had to go to Congress 2 weeks before July and say, you guys got to do something. You got to shut this down because we're not going to make money. Like, well, a little late for that. I'm
yeah.
sorry.
They just go, that's what you
What are you, five?
Yeah, yeah, I'm five. That's what that's
But yeah, I'm not broken up about it. Not one bit.
They did this to themselves.
That's No, absolutely. And that's why I think that the last thing he said was kind of ironic. He said, "Quote, you can lean back and do nothing and then just wait and see what happens." Or you can say, look, we're in it. This is a new era. We need to take advantage of it, pivot as much as we can toward the areas that he was talking about, and embrace the change rather than fighting it. I'm like, yeah, you're doing that now because you literally have no other option.
You have to.
It's
yeah.
either this or don't exist. You know, and so I feel like that was all a little too late. So while Mark Emmert might be accepting it now, it just looks kind of ridiculous on our side of it and everyone else's when they're like, hey, like you said, Zach, you had this opportunity to do this a long time ago. You waited and hoped that
Absolutely.
Things would change. Mm-hmm. They didn't. And now look where we're at. The NCAA is virtually unneeded anymore. So it's a really interesting situation where we're seeing them. And I'm telling you guys, in a few years, it's going to become another part of it where we're talking about the NCAA potentially at least existing in a completely different format or for completely different reasons. When we come back in hour number two on the afternoon sports drive, we'll get into some buy or sell. That's coming up next on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. And I don't know how we make it out. Welcome in to hour number two of the afternoon sports drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network on this Friday afternoon. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, and Levi Peckinpah with you live at Van Chevrolet Buick GMC in Perry, just off I-35 at Perry exit 186. New vehicle demand continues to be greater than supply, so when you visit Van Chevy Buick GMC in Perry, you see the vehicle you want, you get it. Here at Vance, when a new vehicle comes in, their average is about 12 hours until it's sold and out the door. So if new is what you want, urgency is the key. Go to vancechevrolet.net for all current inventory and pricing. To get started in the second hour, we're going to get into some buy or sell.
Are you buying?
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Or are you selling?
You'll pick up the phone and you'll sell, sell, sell.
This is Buy or Sell on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Make money, money, make money.
Buy or sell here on the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, and Levi Peckinpah with you guys. All right, so
we did learn as well yesterday, on top of all of our Big 12 Media Days coverage, about Oklahoma State basketball grabbing the former five-star Musa Cisse. I believe I said that as correct, or as close to correct as I might be able to get here. But yes. Musa Cisse coming out of Memphis over to Oklahoma State, going to be have the opportunity to be the five here in this lineup coming up this season. So buy or sell that Cisse averages 10 plus points per game in his first season with Oklahoma State. We see him putting up decent numbers and having a chance to get into double figures consistently.
I would tentatively buy that. I'm high on him. Don't get me wrong. I'm excited to see what he can do. Within the next month or so, there's typically an availability on the practice floor, so we get to go out and watch a practice and watch some drills and then talk with players and coaches. You look at what he did in the AAC, he averaged 6.6 and 6.3 rebounds a game, and I want to say 1.6 blocks per game. Was solid. He's the AAC Freshman of the Year, really good. He was a five-star prospect out of high school, the number 10 overall prospect out of the 2020 class. Is solid, and we talked about it, and he was just a few ticks shy of averaging 7-7 and being like the third Memphis player since 92-93 to do so. I like for him to get into double figures multiple times this year.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to go out and say that he's going to get a ton of double doubles, but I like the fact that he can go out there. He's a physical player in the paint. He's tall. He has a 7'4 wingspan, and I want to say 9'3, 9'4 standing reach. He's huge.
I'm getting happy over
6'10",
here.
6'10", 6'11", 220, and I mentioned it on the show, and I mentioned it on Robert's show. I can guarantee that he hasn't had a workout like he's going to get when he gets to Stillwater. With Jake Manzelman, and it's Oklahoma State athletics across the board with how hard these workouts are. I don't think it's out of the realm to say that he could easily put on, anywhere between 5 to 15 pounds. When you add, anywhere between 5 and 15 pounds to someone who's 6'10", 6'11", with a 7'4 wingspan, and a 9'4 standing reach, I like him at the five. You're able to move KB and MA to the four. You can kind of cycle those guys down low. I like for him to get into double figures quite a bit this season. I like for him to get into double figures in rebounds. I think that's one of the missing links, mm-hmm. is rebounding down low. I don't know. I know I said I would tentatively buy it, but I don't know. I don't want to say that he is gonna average 10 plus points a game. I think that the capability is certainly there. I think that it is possible for him to go out there and average at least 10 points a game. So I would give me a push. give me the first push, right, because I'm on the fence, because if it's not 10 points a game, then it's like, 9.4, 9.5. It's close to 10. Yeah. So I would give me a push and ask me in 9 months.
Well, we're basically going like, do you think he has that possibility?
I think he has the potential.
I think
for
easily
sure
he can. What have I been pushing for over the past couple months on this show?
Big man.
That's what Oklahoma State's needed. When you got about 20,000 guards that are pretty much interchangeable, you need big man stability.
And they didn't go out and just get a body out of the portal. They went out, and now I get it. I get the whole talk. Well, Walkman didn't work out at Memphis. Well, there's a lot of reasons why guys don't work out at school. Stuff happens. But when you're a top 10 prospect, mm-hmm. in a class, and you're a five-star prospect, chances of you being a washout are probably pretty slim.
And you're coming from a name like Memphis that, if you go back to, I believe it's the previous year's draft, if I remember right, the number two guy in the NBA draft, James Wiseman.
Yeah, number one overall prospect.
Yeah, of course, he only had two games in Memphis because of
legalities
of Penny Hardaway getting U-Hauls.
There may be a reason why this cat's leaving. It may not be because of turmoil.
Yeah, Memphis got a lot of things going on their side that they need to figure out. But for him to come over here, I'm fine with it. Because basically, he's let's be real. He was basically averaging 7-6 and 2 blocks a game. We'll do all of that rounding.
Big get.
I think he can have that jump up in his sophomore year, especially on the Big 12 level. It's all going to depend on, can he translate from the AAC to the Big 12? That's going to be the whole thing. You're going to get the whole non-conference to figure out what he can do for the team and then where his place fits. Is he like your starting sixth man off the bench? Is he your starting center?
I think the fact that you bring in a talented big and you put him with a very athletic team,
mm-hmm.
and I think both can cause each other to thrive.
Right. I think the other thing you got to figure out is, because we know that Caleb Boone back half of the season did really well for himself, but remember, at the start of the season, the main thing was a mental click. Is he going to hit that mental click again and go back off, or because with all the potential of this Oklahoma State team, is he going to put all of that aside and gel with the team? Because I could see a nice three-man rotation between Matthew Alexander, Moncrief, Caleb Boone, and Moussa Cisse, and literally just have them all close to the same minutes and just switch them all in and out, because they're all pretty close to the same height. Yes, Caleb is 6'9", but both M.A. and Cisse are both standing at 6'11", so you can switch them all in and out and be fine with it. I think it's going to be a buy. I think all of your big men are going to be averaging some good numbers, maybe all of them close to that 10-point mark, maybe all close to that decent rebound mark, but I think all these guys are going to have some good averages this season.
Yeah, I'm gonna sell for now. It's going to be close. I like the idea of 8 to 9 points a game, but to me, the biggest thing about this is he's going to be a rim protector, and that's what you need on defense. And the biggest beneficiaries of this for me as well, unless he just, you know, has a huge year, which would be great, but the biggest beneficiaries is going to be a guy like Caleb Boone, absolutely, and Matthew Alexander Moncrief. That's what I said yesterday. If they're sitting there with an actual five in the middle of the floor, that gives them the ability to use their athletic ability, their height, and skill to get to the rim even more. And I think they're going to have the chance to score the most, you know, to actually score the most points when it comes to your bigger guys out of all this. So he's going to be helping everyone else while he's out there, and defensively is going to be the big part for me. How well does he protect the rim? And will that translate into the other side? Can he run the floor? Can he get good looks? So I'm excited about this. I think Oklahoma State is a big get for them. They need this five, and it's going to open up a lot of different things for a lot of other people. That's for sure. Zach, what's yours today?
Yeah, so I'm sticking with it, actually. I'm going to stick with Cisse. I think the general thought process, at least amongst us, is you're looking at Cisse at the five. That's, you know, he's got the size, he has the physicality, he certainly has the length. So buy or sell, Cisse starts more than half of the games this season. I don't want to say most of the games, but starts more than half the games this season at the five.
Buy. Yeah, I'm buying that as I try to make some NSYNC reference. But yeah, I think that's very much possible because what he brings to the floor, it's just seems like a raw defensive athlete with still a lot of great scoring potential, because like you said, basically almost averaging 2 blocks a game. That means that man is definitely an athletic freak with a really big emphasis on the defensive end. Mm-hmm. And that's definitely something that a lot of teams really need, some kind of guy like that to lean on. I mean, that's how Texas, even though once we're talking to the NCAA tournament, they flopped. But that's how they won the Big 12 tournament, was leaning on a guy like Jericho Sims, who, yes, gifted athletically, but defensively was a solid unit and had his best game of his career against Oklahoma State in that Big 12 title game. So I think this is definitely going to be, again, copying a different scheme, but I think him at the five, I think you're going to have him starting a good chunk of the games this season. I'll buy.
Yeah, I think unless, again, it goes back to him being, if he's really consistent on both ends, then he earns that starting position. On the other side of it, it's going to be playing matchups, because there might be some times where you feel like, hey, you know, we can throw our guards out there and M.A. and Caleb in the starting five and give us maybe not as much overall size, but gives us a lot of athletic ability and we get some speed out there. It depends on who you're playing against. But hopefully, for you know, the entire purpose of getting this guy, Cisse, I think that if he does show real quick and early in the season that he can do it on defense, he can get it up there on offense, he's a big part of what the game plan is, he might force Mike Boynton to make him a starter at some point. So I think I can buy that, but initially we'll see matchup-based and go from there.
Yeah, and I didn't want to say, you know, like more than I didn't want to say start most of the season – you know, at the five, because I don't think he's going to be a situation where he absolutely replaces Caleb Boone.
No.
Because I think Caleb Boone is still an integral part of this offense. I think he's going to be very successful. But when you look at this guy, you look at his height, you look at the capabilities he brings in, the length, his shot blocking ability, his rebounding ability. You look at the number of double doubles he had last year. I think the fact that you now have that, and like I said, if you can put, you know, anywhere between 5 and 15 pounds on him, mm-hmm. He's already a force down low. But if you can bulk him up a little bit while keeping that same physicality and that same mentality, I think it's very safe to say that Oklahoma State has found their five. Now, there may be games where, you know, KB gets the start, you know, or KB gets the start at the four. You know, so it's not, he's not completely replacing KB, and KB's coming off the bench.
Mm-hmm.
But I would buy it. I think Cisse is gonna start at least half the games at the five. And like you said, Patrick, I think matchup's gonna be a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
I would buy half the games and give me a bonus buy that he starts. I'll just say the first game of the season at five.
Bonus buy. Okay.
Bonus buy. Give me a buy at the – he'll start game one.
I didn't know you could afford the time for a bonus buy.
I can afford anything, baby.
You sure about that?
Money bags.
Okay. All right, I'm going to move over to mine. I'm going to move out of the NCAA. We're going to go to the NFL because we found out recently via the news that Tom Brady apparently played all of last year with a torn MCL. Yes, the GOAT made his GOAT status elevate a little bit more by playing all of last year with a torn MCL.
Oof.
So buy or sell, because we haven't heard the news if he's had, I believe we haven't heard the news if he's had surgery on it. But
I think he did. At some point in the offseason, I think so.
I believe so he has.
Yeah, he did. He had surgery. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll go off the thing that he's had surgery. Buy or sell that he will miss the first couple of games of this upcoming season because he's recovering from that MCL surgery.
I would.
The thing with Tom Brady is, go ahead, Zach.
No, I was just gonna say, I would probably sell the first game of the season. I could see him setting out most of the preseason games. Mm-hmm. You know, I could see that. I would probably sell him missing a regular season. I mean, if he played an entire, if it's true. And he did play an entire season on a torn MCL, and depending on when he had surgery, like, because obviously he tore it, but it wasn't, it obviously wasn't bad enough that it kept him off the field. And I know that that Adam Schefter came out and he was like, yeah, it was pretty bad. It was a full tear, and he had surgery on it. But if it wasn't bad enough to keep him out of a regular season mm-hmm. and a playoff run and winning a Super Bowl, if he had surgery directly after the season, it wasn't a full, you know, reconstructive knee surgery. I would buy preseason games, but I would sell him missing the start of the season.
Yeah, I think what's wild about it is that he, you know, hurt his knee when he was still with the Patriots. It eventually turns into a torn MCL. He plays the season with it and does what he did, right? With the amount of yards, it wasn't just the Super Bowl. It was nearly 5,000 yards. He had 40 touchdowns. I mean, it was just that. In case you needed any more reason to understand why he is different. It's really unbelievable. And of course, the timeline might be a little muddy as far as the recovery, because it is a little worse maybe than a lot of people thought. It was fully torn, like we mentioned, requiring the surgery. But I'm telling you, I think what we know from Tom Brady, the fact that he played through this, if there's a chance that he will be, like, even if there's a very, very slight chance, the doctor's like, yeah, you know, you can go out there, maybe give it caution, you know, give it a little more time, but I can't completely tell you it's not playable. That's all he needs to hear. And even then, I think Tom Brady's basically going to make the call here. So I would say he's going to be out there for week one. I would be surprised. If there's any chance at all that he can absolutely play, then he will. He's not going to let anything stop him in that category, especially coming off that Super Bowl year. What's, again, more impressive, if you go back to what he did when he was in New England and he hurt his knee, he knew going into that season, this last season with Tampa Bay, that's a very good chance that playing on it was only going to make it worse, and it did. But it was, you know why it was worth it? He wins the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And it's just unbelievable, because players usually aren't going to risk things like that. Tom Brady didn't think twice about it. He went out there, played hurt, won a Super Bowl. No big deal.
Yeah. How many times have we doubted Tom Brady at this point?
My dad doubted him last year, and the old boy just went out and won a Super Bowl.
Yeah, went out, won a Super Bowl, and just laughs in all of our faces. And we all just sit here crying because our teams are never anywhere near the Super Bowl. We'll accept you, Patrick, but then two interceptions and not a touchdown, and the Super Bowl happens. But Tom Brady...
Yeah, we like to forget about that part.
So yeah, we want to forget about that part. But Tom Brady is the ageless one, or it doesn't matter. Anything can pop up, and he is going to overcome it. I think he's starting at the start of the season. I think this injury, I assume almost a couple days after the Super Bowl and after he got way too drunk on a boat, he definitely had surgery on it, and he should be okay by the start of the season.
I could see him. I could see them dragging him off the boat and taking him to an orthopedic center.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, Tom, we're gonna store you in a room for a few days. We're gonna let you come down, and then we're gonna wheel you in.
Yeah, I figured you seen that picture where there's a guy right next to him. They're carrying him off the boat.
That's the surgeon.
Yeah, that's the surgeon.
All right, Tom, come on. We told you 20 minutes ago. You gotta get off the boat.
Well, no one's looking. Also, Cameron Bray is literally holding his feet up off the ground, like.
So that's what it was.
Yeah.
He was too drunk to support his knee.
Yes.
Because when you're sober,
yeah,
you know the limits.
Yes.
When you're drunk, you ain't got no limits.
Exactly.
And so that's like Tom's walking around going like, damn, my knee kind of hurts. Well, Tom, limp a little, please. Quit putting pressure on your leg, and so we'll just carry you. You know what? We don't need a full reconstructive surgery. We'll carry you.
Goodness.
Tom, you will have surgery whether you like it or not. I'm going to stay with the NFL because Chad Ochocinco had some words the other day about how he feels in particular one team has a really solid rapport. Gave a ton of high praise to the Washington football team with scary Terry McLaurin. And, of course, them having this opportunity to bring over Curtis Samuel, who we know can do anything, really, amongst others, Logan Thomas, the tight end. And I think he's got a point. It's going to be a lot of talent. He gave a lot of credit to a guy like Ryan Fitzpatrick, too, who a lot of people expect to be at QB starting this season for the Washington football team. So with all that being said, Scary Terry's still the guy. So buy or sell. Last year he did have that 1,000-yard season, but buy or sell that he sets a new career high in receiving yards this year with Fitzmagic at the helm. For reference, last year his career high that he set was 1,118 receiving yards. So buy or sell, he breaks that this year.
Yeah, I will do the biggest of biggest buys. I think if we're looking for like breakout wide receiver of the year, I'm going Terry McLaurin. Because Terry McLaurin is with the best version of the Washington football team yet. Whether it's you have a teammate who can now take pressure off you with Curtis Samuel, your best quarterback possible that you've had in Ryan Fitzpatrick, which that's sad, that's saying something. But this is going to be the breakout year for Terry McLaurin. This is what's – you're going to have him definitely the most wide receiver numbers that he's had, whether it's yards, whether it's touchdowns. I expect a big number of touchdowns. Hopefully – if for Terry McLaurin's sake, it's double digits. But I think it's going to be a very big year for a guy like Terry McLaurin because this is the first time in his NFL career that he's being truly set up for a big leap of success. So I'm going to big buy for Terry McLaurin.
Yeah, I'll buy Levi's buy. Absolutely. Buy.
Buy?
Sure.
Okay.
Buy. Yeah. Levi gave my answer.
Yes.
I'm buying it is because you look at what he did last year and how many quarterbacks did Washington go through. I mean, and he managed to do that with a bunch of different arms. He did it with Taylor Heineke at the end of the year. Scary Terry is scary, man, plain and simple. There's a reason he has that name. When he gets the football, it's unbelievable. His speed, he'll get past you and you won't even know it. And I think Ryan Fitzpatrick is going to pepper him with targets. And also a guy like Curtis Samuel is going to take some of the defense away from him. And you getting single coverage on Terry McLaurin, it's over. I'm with you, Levi. I think it's going to be a big year for him. I expect him to break that record that he set last year for himself in a big way. I think it's a big time up for the season. And I can't wait for come fantasy football time. It's going to be a big buy as well in that category to get him, somewhat early, I believe, if people are smart. So, yeah, I'm going to buy that big time. I can't wait to see what he does.
Hey, as long as those numbers aren't on my Dallas Cowboys, I don't care. But as long as they're not on my Cowboys, man.
He's going to go out and haul in, like, 215 and three touchdowns.
Oh, he would. He would. And I would be sitting there sad but also happy because I know he will be on my fantasy team.
So I'm sticking football, but I'm going college.
All right.
Going college.
Okay.
So we all heard the exuding of confidence from Spencer Sanders. We heard Mike Gundy. We heard what he had to say about the offensive line. Levi didn't get to see it, but when we asked him about Danny Godlewski, the elation and the joy on his, it was like, oh yeah, I'll get to talk about Danny Godlewski.
Yeah.
So with everything that we learned from Mike Gundy and Spencer and what we heard about Tim Rattay, buy or sell Spencer, and I struggled with the length of games, but I went simple. Buy or sell, Spencer doesn't have a turnover. I also changed it from interception. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have a turnover in the first three games.
So basically the non-conference.
Three non-conference, because Missouri State shouldn't be an issue.
Right.
Tulsa's not going to be as good as they were last year, but Boise's, it's on the road, and Oklahoma State should win that game, but Boise will be tough. Mm-hmm. So buy or sell, he doesn't have a turnover in the first three games.
I'm going to sell, mainly because I think it's going to be against Boise State where you're going to have one. I think when you're going on the road to that Boise State field, that big ocean blue field where it's going to be a little bit of a struggle because we've never been on the type of field that before.
I love Malcolm's and Spencer's answer. They're like, man, I grew up playing it. I can't wait. Yeah. I'm ready to be on that blue turf.
Yeah, exactly. They've been playing all that NCAA. It's like, that blue turf looks amazing. I think Boise State will be a little bit of trouble. I always think that matchup is always a little bit of a coin toss of what type of Boise State shows up, because for that, to me, it isn't what type of Oklahoma State comes. I think that usually Oklahoma State is prepared for any type of battle, but it's what type of Boise State's going to show up. And I think because of what happened in their previous matchup, that Boise State's going to want to come back for some revenge. So I think Spencer's going to have a little bit of difficulty there, and hopefully by then it's full adjustment. He is fully clicking like how he was in that Miami game. But I'm going to expect one interception in that Boise State game.
I'll sell as well because the fact that he kept it a turnover, you know, that could mean, you know, he fumbles the ball, he throws an interception. But to me, I think it's going to happen in the Tulsa game personally, just because of, you know, Tulsa, look at him last year. Obviously, Zaven Collins is gone. We know that. But I don't expect him to lay over. I will say this, though, when the interception or fumble, whatever it's going to be, happens in that Tulsa game, it's not going to matter. It's going to be one of those situations where either it doesn't come back to bite them because you're going to take care of Tulsa, or you're already up by so much. It's just one of those, hey, what we can do with this pass, or maybe, you know, I'm moving out of the pocket a little too late, which, again, that's something I think we're going to expect a lot from. We talk about Spencer Sanders' adjustments. Okay, that means that he's getting his reads down quicker. That means that he's understanding when a pocket is collapsing. But games, I just expected, you know, if he doesn't, then we're going to be talking about, wow, that's some, he had some great ball protection, and that's a big time boost to what we saw last year.
Mm-hmm.
But I think at some point you're going to run into at least one turnover. But I will say this, I don't think it's going to matter much in the grand scheme of things through those three games.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's so, because you look at it I know what Robert says about Missouri State, and they finished the spring season of the FCS, finished ranked, and they beat a couple of playoff teams. But it's
Zach. Let me cut in on you real quick, because I you said that too, and I've heard Robert say, like, Missouri State's not going to be an issue at all. Like I know it's fun to go back and look what they did last year, and I talked to the, you know, play by play guy last couple weeks ago, whatever it was, and he gave us some good information on it. But they're not going to be a problem at all. I mean, halftime that thing will be over, and we all know it.
That's the thing is, like, I get that Missouri State was good in FCS, but they didn't play in the fall. They played in the spring, so that's you only got about 6 months to prep. But it is Missouri State, you know, and you look at what Oklahoma State brings back. I pray to God Oklahoma State doesn't overlook this team. I think even if they overlook them, Missouri State ain't going to win that game. I don't think it's going to be close. But if there is a turnover, it won't be against Missouri State. And if it is, it's like you said, it's going to be one of those – you know, it doesn't matter kind of a turnover, because the defense is going to come up with a stop, or it'll be towards the end of the half, and he tries to force something, you know, to try to put some points on the board before halftime and before they bring in a backup quarterback. I'm not discounting Tulsa, because they're still a respectable program, but this is not the same Tulsa as they were last year. I don't think Oklahoma State is going to have an issue with Tulsa, especially if they're healthy. Oklahoma State is healthy. Boise State could be a problem, but again, I don't think it's going to be like I'm trying to force something in here. or I'm taking way too long in the pocket because I can't figure out which progression I want to go to, and I get a, you know, there's a strip sack. See, there you go. I wasn't hung up on it this time. I mm-hmm. used it in the proper term, strip sack. But I would probably sell, but I don't think it's going to be a meaningful turnover. I think it's, like you said, I think it's just going to be one of those turnovers where it happens and it's not going to be that big of a deal. We're not going to be like, oh, great, here we go again. Spencer's got his troubles. I think it's just going to be one of those things. And I'm with you. If we get through the first three games and mm-hmm. there are no issues, it's non-conference, so you got to take it with a grain of salt. But if you can get through Tulsa and Boise State without Spencer allowing a turnover, I think that then you're looking pretty good going into those, especially the first two games of the Big 12 season, because what is it, Kansas State and Baylor, I think, are the first two Big 12 games. Mm-hmm. So that's get through those. I'm excited. So I would sell it, but tentative sell, because I don't think it's going to be a bad turnover.
Oh, yeah. I really hope I hope that's true and that doesn't happen, because if you can get that type of Spencer against K-State, which I think that's when you're really going to need Spencer to first turn up, is against K-State, oh, then it's going to be such a great time. Now, for my buyer side, I know we got to go quick because we need to get into break. But a man by the name of, yes, Barry Bonds. It's not the official Barry Bonds, but he's a podcaster from the In Real Time podcast, reported that Damian Lillard wants out of Portland, that he's requested a trade. And yes, this is just a guy on a podcast, not actual Damian Lillard. Damian Lillard went on, I think it was like an ESPN radio just a little while ago, and saying that this is not true. But now, since this is all out in the air, buy or sell within the next couple of days, Damian Lillard actually does not request a trade in Portland.
The next couple of days I would probably sell, but I mean, it's like Russ with Oklahoma City. Mm-hmm. I mean, Damian Lillard can only do so much with Portland. And you could have all the love and respect in the world for Portland, but there's only so much he can do, and I think he's done it. But so I would buy long term, but in the next 2 days, I don't think he'll come out and be like, yeah, I want to leave.
Right.
Yeah, I'll buy that he doesn't request it in the next couple of days, but I do think it's coming. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm glad that he addressed the whole – because there was that idea of this guy that talked about on True Hoop, like, oh, did he mean it? Is this real? And, of course, it's, you know, probably just some rumors. But there's obviously been a lot of interest, as we know, from the Knicks that are looking at this situation. They want him. And you remember what Dame said after when they got bounced by the Nuggets, right? Like, he was ticked. Mm-hmm. And I really feel like overall for him – he needs to get out of there. As much as I appreciate his talent, you got to stop wasting it with a team right now like the Portland Trailblazers. And what are they doing that's going to help him out? So at some point, you got to bet on yourself. And I think Dame's too talented, and he wants to get that ring. He needs to go somewhere else. So I think it's coming, but in the next couple of days, not quite, but it is coming down the line.
It's not happening for the next couple of days. I'm going to at least give it a season before Damian Lillard actually asks for a trade talk.
You think he'll be back in Portland this year?
Yeah, I think he will. The main thing is, this is the first time in his career that Terry Stotts is not the head coach of the Portland Trailblazers. It'll be Chauncey Billups in his first attempt in Portland. I think Chauncey's actually going to one, elevate Damian Lillard's game, because of course one great point guard to another, I think it's going to level up his game just a little bit. And I think for once you're going to see Portland actually go out and make some big moves. I think you got a good shot of seeing some of these guys that are in the trade rumors, whether it's a Ben Simmons, whether it's some of these other players, end up over in Portland. I think you got a shot that Portland, they realize that their clock with Damian Lillard is ticking. Even though I think at some point Damian Lillard, he's really been foreshadowing that he would not mind staying in Portland for his whole career. He seems like one of those guys where he could be a legacy type of player. But a ring is a ring, man. If you can get that, then that would most likely push Damian Lillard into the Hall of Fame. So I think that at least for a year, you're going to still have Damian Lillard as a Portland Trailblazer. But if they don't make some type of push, then I could see next year Damian Lillard asking for a type of trade. But I think for at least this upcoming season, Damian is not leaving.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting storyline to follow, that's for sure. When we come back in the afternoon sports drive, Richard Sherman made the news over the last couple of days for some crazy things. We'll talk about that next, coming up, afternoon sports drive. I'll catch you. Afternoon sports drive here on the Triple Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, and Levi Peckinpah with you live from Van Chevrolet Buick GMC in Perry, just off I-35, Perry exit 186. make sure you visit them at vancechevrolet.net. So over the last couple of days, we were trying to monitor the whole Richard Sherman situation going on, where he was arrested, booked, all this stuff, and we now have a home surveillance video to back everything up here. Richard Sherman was heavily intoxicated and apparently went over to his in-law's house and was attempting to break in. Richard Sherman, of course, as we know, former Seahawks star, formerly 49ers. There was a lot of talk that maybe he goes back to the Seahawks, but that might be on hold for a while based off this. I saw the video today of him trying to break into the in-law's house. It was just absolutely unbelievable how hard and aggressively he was trying to bust through this door. I just cannot believe it. There was a 911 call where they said Sherman was under the influence of alcohol. He had said, they said, drunk nearly two bottles of hard liquor, apparently threatened to kill himself during all this stuff. So he got into a really serious situation, was accused of getting into a fight with his wife's uncle, was really aggressive towards police that arrived that morning. He was pepper sprayed by his father-in-law, and then he received an injury from a canine unit that the cops had to use on him. Apparently that's how much he was not cooperating, which is just wild. And then, of course, you know, he comes out and he gives this official apology on his Twitter page, and said this: "I am deeply remorseful for my actions on Tuesday night. I behaved in a manner I'm not proud of. I've been dealing with some personal challenges over the last several months, but that's not an excuse for how I acted. The importance of mental and emotional health is extremely real, and I vow to get the help I need." And goes on to just say, appreciates everybody. And I got to say this, you know, it's this is going to be the opposite of what everybody is expecting to hear. But when it comes to a situation like this, it's one thing to claim that, hey, look, I've got personal problems. I've got some stuff going on with my mental health. And maybe he does. You know, I don't pretend to know whether he does or doesn't. But I don't believe that it justifies in any way what I saw on that video. Trying to break in like he did and then doing what he did apparently with the police. He's clearly got a lot of problems going on, no doubt. But I can't tell you. I mean, with the idea, I think the saying of and the excuse of mental health sometimes is overused, because there are situations where it is completely real. And that's just my opinion. I know that. Especially as is known as well by most people, that when it comes to men in particular, you don't hear a lot about it, right? It's tried, and especially with athletes, that's become kind of a thing recently where athletes have stepped up and talked more about it. But this to me is just a situation from what I'm seeing where Richard Sherman had a ton of liquor in his system. He was extremely angry, had a lot of rage going on, and his one goal, I mean, go and watch that video if you haven't yet, his one goal is to break in. And if he does, who knows what happens. How violent he was in that video, we may be talking about a completely different thing if that door doesn't stand in the way of Richard Sherman. So while I understand that he's probably got some problems and I want him to get some help and figure things out, I feel like, to me, this was just a situation where he was extremely violent, had a lot of bad intentions, and alcohol definitely helped to exasperate that a little bit.
Yeah, so I think that I like the fact that he, you know, that's not, you know, I've been going through a lot the past several months. It's not an excuse for what I did. I don't think that I don't think whatever he's struggling with mentally caused him to do what he did, trying to break into that house, and how violent and how physical he was trying to get into that house. Then you had obviously the altercations that happened after that. But I think I don't know what he's going through, but I think that's what led him to drink as much as he did. And so I'm not excusing it, but that's what I think that's probably what it was. And I hope he can figure it out. You know, I've been through some stuff before. I think we've all been through some stuff, and I think you hit on it, Patrick. It's tough. Yeah. You know, I will say that it's easier nowadays than, let's say, you know, 5 or 10 years for a man to admit that he's going through something, and that it's publicly accepted. I think especially if you're an athlete, you're expected to, well, you're a man, all right?
Mm-hmm.
You're tough.
Suck it up.
You've been through it. You're making money. You don't have a reason to be upset. You've got a family, this and that, and so you can't. You're not allowed to go through stuff. So I'm not condoning it at all. But if he is going through some stuff, I really hope that this is, you know, kind of a wake up call. And I never really cared for Richard Sherman, and that may have been because he played for the Seahawks, and I don't like the Seahawks. And then he got traded to San Francisco, and I don't like San Francisco. So I think it's more so that who he played for. But I do wish him all the best. I hope he gets the help that he needs, and I hope that his family can get through this together, because that's awful what they went through.
Yeah, just to look at it for how his past year has been in the NFL, last year he was injured for the majority of the season, and he hasn't been picked up by the San Francisco 49ers, and I know that's just athletically what's happened to him. Right now he's a free agent.
And that could play into it.
Oh, yeah.
You go from being one of the best to not getting picked back up.
To not being picked up.
Even on your own terms.
And then whatever's happening to him personally off the field, we don't know. It's not an excuse for what he was doing, because we don't know what his intentions are, or anything personal life or what's going on. That's no excuse. And he said it's not even an excuse. So all I can really do is just wish him personally that he seeks the help that he wants. And maybe within the next couple years, maybe he gets a shot back in the NFL. Because I think that definitely has to hurt a lot whenever you are at the top of your game just a couple years ago. You were in the Super Bowl just a little while ago, and now you're back here. I would think that would have to hurt. If you're at the top of your game somewhere, then you get taken down so many pegs, and it may not even be your fault, even if you still think you're good at what you do, then it's definitely got to hurt. That's probably something that went into it a little bit, but I can't speak of what's in the mind of Richard Sherman, but I just hope that he finds the help that he needs. And I know he's got a lot of love from a lot of players in the NFL and a lot of people surrounding the NFL, so I just hope that he gets the help that he needs.
Yeah, no, it's a crazy, crazy situation, no doubt. We come back on the Afternoon Sports Drive. We'll play Spencer Sanders sat down with myself and Zach yesterday at the Big 12 Media Days, gave us a lot of good sound bites, a lot of good information about this upcoming season. So we'll let you take a listen to that when we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Quarterback for Oklahoma State, Spencer Sanders is going to join us here. And Spencer, what's going on, man? Thanks for giving us some time.
Nothing much. Just, you know, glad to be here.
How's the rounds been so far? Been what is this, like stop number 50 already for you over here?
I wouldn't say 50, but I'd say near.
Yeah.
This is pretty cool. You know, I got to interact with some people that I've never seen before, and just kind of meet new faces, see familiar faces too, and just kind of talk with just some good people amongst the league. And like I said, there's great players here from other conferences. You know, you get to see and get to meet and greet, but you know, outside the pads and outside of the season, you know, so that's kind of good, and it kind of slows everything down. And you know, it's good to be here.
Take me through the off season so far for you and your guys, because in particular, what are some things that you've been working on looking ahead to this next season to get you back on track at quarterback?
You know, I feel like this off season was great, especially just kind of going through just development of not only me, but you know, just the offense. You know, saying we move as a team and we do everything as a team, and nobody stands over nobody. There's no I. And so as long as, you know, we just keep holding each other accountable, I mean, we're just going to keep doing what we're doing. We keep our head down and move in silence and let our work do the talking.
So obviously Timmer Tay came in last year, but then COVID happened. No one was really had a spring. No one had a summer. The fall itself was kind of hectic and spread out. What was your first full spring, you know, full on with Coach Tay like?
That was great. I mean, one thing I learned was decision making, and with decision making comes timing, anticipation, footwork. I mean, all that comes into play. Reading the defense, all four of those, I'm pretty sure there's a couple more things kind of come into play of that. And he really kind of developed my footwork, which my footwork developed my mindset. My mindset developed, you know, what I do on the field. And so I feel like it's just, he's helped me in just such a phenomenal way that I can just progress and help this offense.
How does that play into the high that you guys left last season with that huge win over Miami? Personally, I mean, you had a great game. So how do you take that performance, combine it with Rite to where you are right now?
I would just say he's I mean, he's helped me grow. He's helped me grow as an athlete, of not only just on the field but off the field, you know, controlling my emotions and stuff like that. So kind of bringing all that back together, I mean, that goes back to operating the offense. You know, he's helped me operate the offense faster, move quicker, think quicker, you know what I mean? And with all that being said, I mean, he's helped me progress. He's helped me move up.
As far as, and you mentioned there, Spencer, the footwork in particular, we tried, you know, explain a bunch of times that, hey, when it comes to quarterbacks, that's where it starts right there. And whenever you're able to get that down, everything else just kind of follows. And like you said, it has to be something I'm sure Tim Bertay has really just pounded into your head is, hey, start with it down there and everything else is going to come with it.
Yeah, I could say that's like probably the most improved thing I've done so far is footwork. And like I said, I mean, like you could probably ask any quarterback coach or quarterback in here, if your feet aren't in line, you can make plays. Don't get me wrong, you can be that different quarterback, but you know, it's a lot easier. The game moves quicker and it slows down for you with your footwork. You know, and everything's just kind of, it's football at the end of the day.
Yeah, and as far as the receivers, losing a guy like Tylan Wallace, we know it leaves a big hole receiver. But we've heard a lot about some of these guys that are going to have a chance to maybe fill that up. We've seen a guy like Brennan Presley last year, especially. You talk about the Miami game, he really came along. So how's that been so far for you with all these receivers? Maybe some new faces, but also some guys that are going to at least get more time.
You know, I'm excited. You know, you get to kind of see those guys develop and what they can do on the field. And I really feel like they can contribute and they can help this team a lot. I mean, I've seen a lot of these guys do a lot over the offseason and kind of really just contribute to the team. And it's like really, it's kind of the main thing I've been harping on since I've been at this media day the whole time is just accountability. And the thing is it's accountability is really huge with receiver and quarterback. Like, I got to trust when I give you this signal, you're going to run this route. He's got to know, I got to run this route. I got to get there no matter if I get pushed, pass interference. And I think that mindset within just the young receivers is excellent. I mean, they came off sharp, like sharper than you would think, and like you wouldn't expect this out of a freshman. And it's actually great. I mean, the Green Twins are working their tail off. J.P. Richardson, he's working his tail off. Everybody knows BP. BP ain't changed. BP's still doing his thing, you know. And so it's entertaining, really, to watch it all. I mean, they're great athletes, great players, and just watching what they can do with it.
Then you move over to running back as well. You know, Chuba no longer there, but we saw guys last year that helped in with his role as well. LD was a big part of it. We saw Dom. You know, you go down the list of guys, Dez, and there's Mike Gundy said today, look, there's like four or five guys we feel like they could be really good at running back this year. How confident does that give – what confidence does that give you as a quarterback knowing, hey, when I hand this ball off, they're going to make a play?
Yeah, no, it gives me great confidence. I mean, it's just knowing that, you know, it's just like football. You get your run game going, your pass game gets going. You get your pass game going and your run game going at the same time. I'm not going to say you're running up on the stat sheet, but you're probably going to be pretty good on the stat sheet, you know what I mean? So it's just the game of football is just it's patience. You know, you got to have patience. And I really feel like our team is just we've had great patience, you know, through this offseason. We've been waiting for so long. We just got to keep waiting and keep working for the season.
Then you flip the ball over to the other side, and the defense can easily be a huge part of the story this season too with who they return. We just talked to Malcolm, and they're pumped up, obviously excited to get back to where they were last year and improve even more because they were real good. And we talk about confidence. I bet I have to feel like, you know, if you guys on that side, if things aren't going well, you're able to turn it around to the defense and know, hey, they're gonna get the ball back.
Oh, yeah. They displayed that many, many times last season. So it kind of just shows, like, if we can pick up our side, look what we can do. You know what I mean? It's like, and I wouldn't even say me. I mean, if somebody wants to point fingers, you can point fingers at me. I don't, for last season, that doesn't bother me. I don't care because we're a different team and we're just going to let it go. But if we can just convert maybe half of those, you can go back and look at every game. Probably
won every game. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's fair.
I'm not trying to throw that out. No shot at nobody, no disrespect. But, you know, I mean, it's football at the end of the day. Everybody knows what they signed up for.
And then from the offensive line standpoint, last year, on top of your injury, then you have all these injuries on the offensive line. Guys are moving around, doing what they can in different positions, younger guys too. How do you feel about that progression from last year to this year? Of course, you still have a guy like Josh Sills too, who we know has become a vocal leader and a part of this team.
You know, I say that again. I lost.
As far as the offensive line, just how they were last year to this year, because we know they were dealing with the injuries and everything, a lot of moving around. Do you think there's more continuity this year with this offensive line? And how do you feel about them coming in, the confidence level for that?
Yeah, I would say our depth is definitely a lot bigger, and I think it's just especially moving forward. I mean, I wouldn't, you know, you don't look for nobody to get hurt. It's just, it's unexpected, and you hate to see it, and you, I wish that upon nobody. But I would just feel like it's just helped so many people grow. I mean, we had Cole and Hunter Anthony who got hurt. Like, that was the second series of the game. So, I mean, it kind of really shows, like, what's he going to do now? Like, when he got hurt, what's he going to do now? Is he going to step up? Is he going to be a leader? Is he going to let this get the best of him? Or is he going to send himself in a hole? Mm-hmm. And I feel like they both did a very good job of, you know, being a leader, stepping up, being a leader. They both knew they were young. So, you know, what can you do when you're young if you're not playing? You know you can't be a leader versus a veteran. But at the same time, who's stopping you? Nobody's stopping you. I mean, there's plenty of freshmen out there making records as freshmen. So, you know, at the same time, as anybody can be a leader. It's just when you develop and your time is ready and you step up to the plate. And I feel like they really stepped up to the plate and mentally and physically came back better.
When you look at that offensive line, obviously you do bring back a lot of experience, a lot of young guys that had a lot of snaps last year. They played multiple positions, but I think a guy that is really, really going to help this offensive line this year is the Miami of Ohio transfer Danny Godlewski, and obviously when you bring in a center caliber of Danny Godlewski, obviously that's huge for a quarterback. So what does he bring to your game, and what does he bring to that offensive line?
He brings to the offensive line, I mean, obviously just more depth and just that one, you know, that he's just got that dog mentality. Like, I don't care how big you are. I don't care if you're bigger than me. I don't care if you're faster than me. I will outwork you at the end of the day. You will not outwork me. It doesn't matter who you are, or five-star, three-star, don't care. You will not outwork me, and I love that from Danny. And he's just got that dog mentality, you know what I mean? It's just like, I love it. And so it makes me feel more comfortable that, you know, and I got a center that's a dog, you know, like, and nobody wants a wimp as a center. I'm not saying I've never had a wimp as a center. I'm just saying, you know, he makes it known, like, hey, I'm going to block this guy. If he gets out of there, it's my fault. Like, don't take anything else, and don't take – oh, I was fixing to say a bad word. Don't take crap from anybody else, you know. And just keep going, you know what I mean? And that's what I love about Danny. He makes a mistake. I smile at Danny. I say, hey, let's just keep going, man. It's all right.
How excited are you personally, especially as a quarterback, to get back this year to at least somewhat normal, right? You get the full stands and everything like that. The atmosphere is going to be back. How pumped are you to have that back?
I mean, I'm excited. I mean, obviously, as we know, with fans comes momentum. So with momentum comes a W. So let's see where we can take it.
Last thing for you, too. As far as NIL goes and everything like that, that's been a big part of the changes coming into college sports. Has there been any type of change for you personally, any of your players or guys on your team when it comes to NIL, or do you expect that?
I'd say there's a couple changes here and there. There's a couple guys hanging back, and there's a couple guys that are really trying to advance on it. And, I'm just kind of taking it by the ear. I'm not really stepping up in anything. I'm kind of letting the dust kind of fall off so I can see the in and out and the loopholes of everything and just kind of figure out, you know, like, what's going on.
So I'd asked Malcolm about this. As a kid that I'm assuming grew up playing NCAA football on PlayStation or Xbox, what's it going to be like for you going out to Boise State and playing on that blue turf?
I was just going to say that. Yeah, no. I always just play on that field just for fun. Like, it was just fun. But now I get to actually go out there and I'm fixing to step on it and play on it. I couldn't tell you the experience because I don't know yet.
Yeah.
But I hope it's going to be exciting, and I'm excited. As you can tell, I'm getting excited talking about it. Yeah. I'm getting excited for the season. So, you know, I'm more than excited for the season. Like I said, I don't do no trash talking, no disrespect. I let my work do the talking. So we're going to see.
That was OSU quarterback Spencer Sanders. We really appreciated him giving us some time, and Big 12 Media Days was a lot of fun. That's going to do it for us today on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Thanks to Vance, Chevy, Buick, and GMC. And for Levi Peckinpah and Zach Lancaster, I'm Patrick Wheeler. Everyone have a fantastic weekend.